Welcome back to Zero Tolerance for another episode of Learn to Burn with Practical Machinists. Today we're going to talk about something very common that is ultimately challenging to make. It's the little registered trademark symbol on almost all injection molded parts that have a logo of some kind, and it's this little R. And even logos of all kinds, they can be very challenging, and we've been doing it for a long time with very small cutters with some success, but we've broken a lot of tiny cutters, and I'm going to try to show all the different sizes of these small cutters. Cutting electrodes, it's not bad, but they do wear out and they don't last very long, and we've come across a way to utilize another method of making very detailed electrodes that can achieve this small detail. Here are a couple common parts that are injection molded that have this registered trademark symbol on it. You can see it, it's right there. It's very tiny. It's on this part here. Some of them are embossed in the plastic and some of them are raised plastic. On our Sharpie pens, on our all kinds of different products, they have this little mark. So we're going to try to focus on showing how small these little marks can get. I made the mistake one time of leaving it off of one of the parts that we were supposed to have it on, but it was so small, it was almost impossible to get it on there. And we've discovered a way to get it on there. All right, here's an electrode that we made for this part, and you can very barely see what we cut in there as a registered trademark. It was done with a 10,000th diameter ball cutter. It's not, sometimes you just can't get that feature in there. You need to have a 5,000th diameter cutter. Here's another one with some lettering and logos. And these are surprisingly simple, but they're difficult to produce sometimes, just because you're trying to squeeze a small cutter into a smaller space than you have. And with electrodes, you have overburn, obviously. So your features actually end up getting, they're not to size and dimensions. So we've discovered a way using a laser to actually etch those in there correctly. And I'm gonna go through how that looks. And I'm gonna go through how these cutters sizes get very small, almost the size of a human hair. And the limitations of them, how deep you can go, how long they last. And let's discover what it's like to do this. Okay, here we have our typical cutters. These are inches. Inch dimension. So this is an 1/8 inch cutter. We got a 1/16, a 1/32, and I believe a 15,000th cutter. Now, when we're cutting logos, we need to go even smaller than this, and I'll show this in the CAD files in just a second. But here is what a 10,000th cutter looks like. I kind of don't want to drop it because it's easy to break. And sometimes, even when you do a tool changer, we're going to set it up here. You can see how small it is in my hand. That's a 10,000th cutter. Now I'm trying to show you how small this really is. It doesn't seem like it's that small until you compare it. So there's a 10,000th is the smallest one. I'm gonna open up this set here, which is even smaller, which I may have just broken. No, let's check it out. We'll see if I did. I think I did. I did, I broke it right off. This is not what I wanted to do. Let me open another one. I shouldn't be allowed to do this. Okay. All right, don't break the cutter. Now, 5,000th is the smallest one I've ever used, and it's so delicate. I literally just bumped it on that cap and broke it. So using these can be expensive because you're trying to cut carbon. You may have to make 4 or 5 electrodes, and you might go through 4 or 5 cutters, and they can get expensive, especially if they're diamond coated. These particular ones are not diamond coated. This is a very rare job we're doing that where we needed to have that small little registered trademark, which my customer absolutely had to have on there. So now that we've seen these cutters, I'm gonna go into the CAD and we'll kind of compare what the cutters look like to the geometry that we're trying to cut. And on the screen, I'll have a 10,000th ball, and it really can't get in there. But there is a witness of what it looks like, and I showed you that electrode, and I'll show you it in the CAD. So let's do that. Okay, here we are with the CAD that we're looking to machine this electrode to represent that registered trademark, which is, it's a 32nd or 32,000ths diameter on the outside. And right here we're showing, I'm gonna show a few different cutter sizes. So right, that's a 20,000ths diameter cutter. And you can see that how small that is. And then here's a 15 and a 10 is actually what we ended up cutting this feature with, just to have a witness of it. Was it critical that we actually made it perfect? It is not. It doesn't show through. The plastic really can't fill in that area in the mold, but it gives you an idea of how small that is. Now, when I go in there and I measure it, you know, some of the features and some of the logo inserts that we've had to make had to have these features very sharp and very precise, and that's where you go down to your 5 thou cutter if you absolutely have to. But you can see this opening on the R is only 4.5 thousandths wide. So that's literally impossible to cut with the 5 thou cutter. So what we have trouble with is trying to get that feature to be perfect, which, being a mold maker, we want to make everything perfect, which sometimes just isn't realistic, especially for how small that is to begin with. So to take a look at this toolpath that we ended up making this work with, if I can turn this on, this is what the toolpath looks like. I just waterfalled it over the top of it, and I'm gonna make it transparent so you can see what it ends up looking like. So it barely witnesses, it kind of looks like a bubble letter R, and that's fine for the electrode in this particular case. And the reason we're wanting to find another way to do it is because of this type of feature. It may not always be the registered trademark, but other logos that are fancier or more detailed, we can do it now differently with using the laser, and I'm going to explain and show you how we do that. This is the registered trademark. I made a sketch in Symmetron to show you what I use to make my file that I'm going to use on the laser. Literally, this is just wireframe of the outside. It's completely hollow. There's nothing to it. It's very simple, but it's good geometry that I can use, and it's accurate to the CAD. And we can measure this. This is actually like the 32,000ths diameter feature. I just want to verify that. Yeah, it's like 32,000ths. So from here, I export this as an image. And I'm not really sure why it works, but this is what I do. I'll take it and do save image as, and then we'll make it, we'll just call it. Here's the logo file that we saved. And I'm gonna open it up in Paint. And I'm gonna show you how I took this file, which was very simple. And I literally used the fill in. I'm not super good at this, so I just fill in that and that, and that's the file that I use. So then I save it, save over it, save as, just save it as a JPEG, and that's it. All right, I got this little R brought into our file that I made, this JPEG in Paint and Symmetron. It looks pretty good. It looks a little fuzzy, but we're gonna see how it works on the laser machine on a piece of ground carbon, which ground blanks we don't use very often anymore since we use our fast mill Aroa 3R systems. But every now and then, or not every now and then, we also take our ground blanks and we make our subgate electrodes from these. So we have quite a few of these. They're ground 3/8 square by 3 inches, and I'm going to attempt to put this registered trademark logo on this electrode. Now I'm hoping, I don't know how to control the depth. So what I've discovered is you can do different passes, different powers. Everybody's laser engraver is different, but I'm gonna just go over some of the basic things that I've done and show you how it works for us. All right, one of the main things for making electrodes is how do we locate the features in this. The best part about logos and lettering is there's a larger tolerance that we can deal with, so we don't have to be perfect. We can be pretty close. For us, we're going to use this square blank And in our laser machine, we got to raise this up or lower it down to get our two laser dots to line up. And that means that it will cut at that surface with the laser. Alright, so now what I need to do is figure out where that's going to be on my blank. So I'm going to do a preview on this particular machine. You can see that little tiny square is the preview. So I'm going to eyeball this just for now. It's roughly in the center. And what we're going to do is we're going to see what it does. I'm going to do a marking. It's going to laser it. And then I want to know a couple of different things. Do I have it scaled properly? And is it roughly, you know, plus or minus 5 to 10 thousandths in the right location and size? So I'm going to mark, and here we go. I basically have 50% power, very, very fast setting. So now let's take a look at this. I don't know if you can see it. I really can't. So I'm going to get all this black soot off of here. And I really can't see it very well. Let's zoom in as much as we can on it. And then we're going to take it to the microscope and see. All right, let's take it over to here. I got to focus this and see if it actually turned into anything. Oh, wow, it did. So there's our little arm. One thing I don't know is I don't know how deep it is. So what I would like to do to discover how deep that is I'm gonna actually go to the edge of the block and engrave with the same settings, that same logo, off the edge of the block, and then we're gonna measure it on the keyons so I can see how deep it goes. Yeah, if I'm close to the right size, so. This is very shaky. Obviously, I got a terrible hand here. So that's roughly about 30 seconds. Did you record that? Oops. So what we're doing here is we're reversing the engraving so it's leaving the R proud and not down. And the other thing is, too, you want to be careful not to mirror your features, because that can be a problem. It looks like we need to investigate how to do this a little better, but it looks like it does work. Our first attempt was nothing. Our second attempt, we were actually able to do it. So I believe we can make this work. But this will apply to a couple different combinations of challenge that we have with small cutters and trying to put those features into logos, lettering, and little register trademarks. Being that the logos and trademarks and all the lettering is on a lot of different plastic parts, I'm curious to know how you guys handle putting those small features in the electrodes or on the blocks. I know that there's laser engraving sources that you can use. Tennebec is one of them. So just curious how you guys handle that kind of stuff. If you have a method to your madness, is there specific cutters that you buy to do it? Do you make your own? I used to make my own single point cutters out of carbide with a deco cutter grinder, just so I could get that engraving in there. It wasn't a specific font, but I could actually get those small letters to come through correctly with just stick font. And that's how I did it most of the time. But logos, they're a different story. I know customers really get specific and real picky about making sure their logo looks as good as it can. So just curious how you guys handle that. I'd love to know in the comments below. All right, so we have just
done our test burn. I've used a 20 VDI finish, a fine graphite, and these are our laser cut electrodes. And I just want to see the results of what it looks like in the steel after we burn down about 5,000s deep. Typically logos and stuff like this can be very very tricky to get the detail to come through. The overburn is hard to control to get the size you want, but you're looking for it to just show up. And this will show up in the plastic part. But I used a 2,000ths overburn, a 20 VDI setting. I could probably go finer, but this is actually what we would do in the tool. And I will be doing this in the future for sure. I made up a couple other electrodes that I wanted to try, a larger registered trademark, and then a couple more different sizes. And we are gonna do two more spots on that block, what right here and here. We're gonna go 5 and 10,000ths deep, and we'll see how it looks in just a minute. All right, so that's that larger registered trademark. And I just wanna answer some questions right now before we go too far. The laser machine is an inexpensive laser, a few thousand dollars. 20 watt laser is all I'm using to do that. And I'm sure I'm gonna get some questions, so I wanna just kind of address them now. There's all kinds of different settings to do in there. I'm still discovering what to use and what works best. From what I could see, I can go, 15, 20,000ths deep in the electrode and get what I want as far as detail. But that's gonna be on your end if you have one, to mess with it yourself. I'm not an expert on that. But I do know that this is gonna be very fun and very helpful to do electrodes. The challenge that we do have is locating that position of the feature or the logo where you want it on the electrode, and I recommend using a fixture that you can repeatedly put them in the same spot or get into your software and you could potentially position it that way. I don't have that figured out, but we do have a good way of getting it close, so I'm just gonna leave it at that. This is exactly what I was trying to do without breaking those tiny cutters and achieving another option to machine those electrodes. So I'm pretty excited. Looks like this is gonna work for a lot of different things. And that's all I have for now. I'm very excited to explain that we are gonna start a new series utilizing 5-axis to build molds. So typically when you have 5-axis, 5-axis is used to make production parts. We're gonna use it to make one-off parts where it's not all about the time, but it's about the precision. It's about how accurate we can make everything in one single setup. So I'm excited to announce that. It will be in addition to our Learn to Burn series, and we look forward to showing you what we find. Thanks for watching another episode of Learn to Burn with Practical Machinist. Remember to subscribe and like, and stay tuned for our new 5-axis series. Lost my mind. We look forward to what we're gonna say next. Okay. I don't know what I'm gonna say. Zero tolerance with Learn to Burn. I just looked over there. Some difficult parts. Machinists, we are zero tolerance and we're here to stay.